Unlock the power of your mind. This is Provocative Enlightenment with Eldon Taylor.
Welcome, and thank you for joining us today. The next 2 hours are devoted to learning something more, not just about the world of shoes and ships and sealing wax, but about how, what, and why we believe as we do. A time for the open-minded, willing to challenge some of those old ideas behind what we think we know and who we might become. In today's episode, we're going to once again examine how we break through self-imposed limitations, limitations that hold us back, keeping us stuck, when there is so much more that we want to experience in our lives. We will examine the questions, who we are, where we want to be, and how we can go about accomplishing that objective. And once more, we'll use the real-life story of a famous and successful person to help us map out our path. So the question, how did I get where I am and how do I get where I want to be, becomes again our central inquiry in this episode of Breaking Limitations. I'm Eldon Taylor, and this is a Provocative Enlightenment Special Investigation. All right, our chat room is open, and my partner Ravinder awaits you there now. You can log on by going to provocativeenlightenment.com/chat. Emphasis on the /chat, she tells me. Okay, Rav, it's time for you to tell us all about your chat room and why everyone should join you there.
Well, I hope everyone will come join me because I like to meet everyone and get their feedback on the show and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. It's a great chat room, a great group of people. So that is provocativeenlightenment.com/chat. You can also just go to that page to get information about our current guest, you know, any information, how to contact them. You know, I post everything right there. So it's a good thing to check out. I also do want to remind people that, you know, a number of our guests have some special offers that they make available just to listeners of Provocative Enlightenment, and we post all of that on the Provocative Enlightenment site. You know, some of our recent guests have had some incredible discounts just for your listeners, honey. Makes you feel good, huh?
Yeah, it does.
So just go to provocativeenlightenment.com and click on special offers, and we make it all very simple for you. So as I said, do join us in the chat room. See you there.
All right. In our Spotlight of the Week feature this week, we look back to the firing of Dr. Lawrence Summers by Harvard University. Many people reported that he was fired for making ridiculous comments about women in math. Swarthmore College Bulletin reported the matter this way, quote, on January 14, 2005, Harvard University President Lawrence Summers unwittingly brought the simmering debate about women's representation in science careers to a full boil. In a keynote speech at a conference on diversity, Summers hypothesized that the shortage of women in certain disciplines could be explained by innate differences in mathematical ability. Summers is quoted as saying, quote, there is relatively clear evidence that whatever the difference in means, which can be debated, there is a difference in the standard deviation and variability of a male and female population. Do note that he said, whatever the difference in means, this is very often misunderstood. The public interpretation of this statement, however, as advanced by the mass media and some academics, although truly inaccurate, was that Summers was saying that women were less proficient at math and sciences than men. I remember hearing the cable networks proclaiming that Summers made the preposterous statement that men and women's brains were different, and that's why women were so outnumbered by men in the fields of math and science. Enter a study reported last week in Science News. The headline read, Brain Connectivity Study Reveals Striking Differences Between Men and Women. Quoting from the article, in one of the largest studies looking at the connectomes of the sexes, Rajani Verma, Ph.D., an associate professor in the Department of Radiology at Perelman School of Medicine at the University of Pennsylvania, and colleagues found greater neural connectivity from front to back and within one hemisphere in males, suggesting their brains are structured to facilitate connectivity between perception and coordinated action. In contrast, in females, the wiring goes between the left and right hemispheres, suggesting that they facilitate communication between the analytical and intuition. The report continues, quote, "For instance, on average, men are more likely better at learning and performing a single task at hand, like cycling or navigating directions, whereas women have superior memory and social cognition skills, making them more equipped for multitasking and creating solutions that work for a group. They have a mentalistic approach, so to speak. Past studies have shown sex differences in the brain, but the neural wiring connecting regions across the whole brain that have been tied to such cognitive skills has never been fully shown before in a large population." Close quote. Now, this study, Ravinder, involved 949 individuals, 521 females and 428 males, aged 8 to 22 years. So the sample size is certainly large enough. Now, I don't think anyone is going to fire Dr. Rajini Verma, since she's a female. So your thoughts on this? I mean, is it okay to accept that the sexes are simply wired differently, and that's how it is? Not to say that this should in any way limit either sex from doing what wiring suggests the other sex as a class is supposedly better fitted to do. Your thoughts?
You know, I think the whole thing is pretty crazy. I think what has happened is people are so obsessed with making everybody equal that they forget that, you know, I mean, equal does not mean the same. It means equal rights. So if you have a female who is 5'2" and weighs 110 pounds, well, she's just simply not going to be as physically capable as a 6-foot man who's 270 pounds. It is just black and white. But on the other hand, you know, you're going to get some females that are bigger and some guys that are smaller. But it's the equality stuff that I think is ridiculous. We all know for a fact that men and women are different. You know, women tend to be more emotional, men tend to be more analytical, but you can't put that down as a hard and fast, you know. I think it's what we need to focus on is equal rights for people. You know, if you have the same abilities at something, if you're doing a job, then you should be paid the same. But I think we need to enjoy, you know, what makes us unique, what makes us special. And females, you know, we like being nurturing as a general. That is not to say every single woman out there craves, you know, being a mom and stuff like that. But we enjoy that. We like taking care of our husbands as long as they don't abuse it.
You know, I agree with you. But, you know, by golly, I got cheated. You know, when you read this study, I should have been a female. You know, brains are structured to facilitate connectivity between perception and coordinated action in males. Okay, so I guess that means you can be a boxer. But women, they've got all the smarts, you know. They're facilitated for multitasking and for solving problems. You know, maybe I should complain. We're being picked on, us as males, huh?
I think you are plenty, plenty smart, gorgeous.
All right. Every week I read some of your letters as our way of paying respect to the very important role you play in making this show successful. Last week our guest was Donna Gates, and she shared her body ecology work with us. Loretta wrote, "Thank you, Eldon and Ravinder. Wonderful show today. I have learned so much and so much more to go. I yearn to learn the right way to eat for me. Thank you, Donna Gates." Mark wrote, "Thanks for the great show with Donna Gates. One of the show's takeaways for me is the importance of fermented foods. I plan to start using fermented coconut water probiotics. Also, as a morning coffee drinker myself, I have a glass of water about 10 minutes beforehand to help hydrate my body." You know, you and I went right out and we bought coconut fermented.
I'm working on getting educated as quickly as I can. I was personally very impressed with Donna Gates's interview. You know, she's very knowledgeable. She's got a great, you know, track record for the stuff that she has done. So, no, I will take her advice to heart and do whatever we can.
Solid interview. I totally agree with you. That's one that everybody can get in the archives, and they should get, too. Okay, Janet wrote, I had so many important questions answered by your show with Donna Gates. Thank you so much for doing what you do. Susan wrote, Eldon, I cannot thank you enough for your show. I love listening to you. I love the show that you spoke about yourself. I loved hearing your personal story. My favorite show was with Gary Renard, as I have been a longtime student of A Course in Miracles and had no idea about Gary's books that really helped to clarify the Course. I have, since your show with him, read all of his books and have renewed my journey through The Course in Miracles. So big thank you for that. I have just finished listening to the Larry Dossey show. I had read his book many years ago and loved it on prayer. I love today's interview. Looking forward to more interviews. Thank you for bringing this to me. Oh, I used your subliminal book to make a subliminal recording for me to ride better. I have exceeded all my aspirations this year and my goals riding my horse. I am hoping to have time to do more of these. I got the book last year at this time, and with its purchase, many things have changed in my life. Well, congratulations, Susan. Now, Susan is speaking of my book, Self-Hypnosis and Subliminal Technology. And if you haven't yet obtained your copy, I noticed just this morning that it's on sale at both Amazon and Barnes & Noble for less than $16. People have paid thousands for the course material included in the book, which comes with a CD packed with hypnotic exercises. I guarantee you it's a great gift as well for anyone. Moving along, Rhonda wrote, I am so very excited to be able to purchase InnerTalk's best program, Personal Power. I have been waiting for the right time to make this purchase since attending a lecture of Eldon's years ago. He is a magnificent speaker as well as a patient and brilliant teacher. I am overwhelmingly flooded with gratitude and joy. Well, thank you, Rhonda, for your support and feedback. You'll love the program, and we look forward to hearing more about your successes. So do write us. Do tell us. Do share. Ravinder, you have the program on sale, and I guess that's what this is all about. So what's the deal there?
It is. We offer this to, you know, subscribers of your newsletter. The Personal Best Prosperity Power is the most complete success package that you have. There are basically 28 programs on 24 CDs. It has a value, now, if you were to buy everything individually, of over $780. And we have it on special right now for $189. These are flying out of the door right now because all of your regular Inner Talk users know that that is the most incredible value, and this is a really good package. I hadn't thought about telling your listeners on Provocative Enlightenment the same thing. What you can do if you are interested in picking up this package as well is if you go to provocativeenlightenment.com and click on special offers. We posted the information just this morning, so you can click on it there and it'll provide you, you know, all the information about the special. But if you don't want to go out to provocativeenlightenment.com, and why you wouldn't is beyond me, but if you don't, you can just go to innertalk.com, and if you write Provocative Enlightenment in the comments box at the end of your order, then we will make sure you get the Personal Best at that super duper price. But it's worth checking out, as I said, checking out the special offers, because there are some other things there as well.
All right, Vita wrote, I downloaded the free InnerTalk MP3s and have been running them in continuous loop in iTunes nonstop on my computer for the past 5 days or so. My downloads included forgiving and letting go and releasing fear, doubt, and feelings of hopelessness and helplessness. And let me tell you, I feel different. I feel motivated with an incredible amount of energy. I feel inspired, on fire. I feel compelled to help people along. These feelings of mine are in complete contrast to how I felt prior to listening to your programs, where feelings of hopelessness and learned helplessness pervaded my mental landscape, and I feel more creative. Thoughts have been popping into my head that don't normally surface. Your InnerTalk programs are magical. You don't even have to know precisely what's on the audios for their power to explode into your life. It doesn't matter, and it's so easy. Just turn on the audios, run them continuously, and go on about your day. I'm 54 years old, and I've been actively transforming my life and mind since I was 18 years of age. I finally found something that is going to elevate my consciousness quickly. I've also just finished reading your book, Choices and Illusions. What a great book. Thank you, thank you, thank you with all my heart. I'll tell you what, Rav, that's the letter that warms my heart. That one feels very good. How about you?
That's what makes it all worthwhile. You know, when you're self-employed, you work. We work really, really hard. And what makes it, you know, what makes it fun is hearing back from all the people we've helped.
Isn't that true? Okay, that's all the time we're going to take for letters today. But I do invite you to opine by sending your email to Eldon at EldonTaylor.com or by joining me on Facebook. We can't get all of your letters on the air, but they do impact our programming. And once again, I both appreciate and thank you for your feedback and continued support. Now, if you're new to this show, you may enjoy our archives. You can find more than 5 years of archives at our site, provocativeenlightenment.com. During that time, we have interviewed Hollywood greats, politicians, psychics, CIA personnel, heart scientists, religious leaders, skeptics, philosophers, social psychologists, best-selling authors, channels, mediums, and more. We have charted the waters of health and wellness, parapsychology, psychic phenomena, UFOs, NDEs, physics, psychology, criminology, neuromarketing, brainwashing, and still more. If any of that sounds like your kind of radio, check out our archives again at provocativeenlightenment.com. Be sure to subscribe to our free newsletter while you're there. Okay, now to this week's show, a special episode of our Breaking Limitations series. Breaking Limitations was originally designed to be a telecourse or webinar, but the interest was so keen that we decided to make it available as a worldwide radio broadcast. Provocative Enlightenment is a syndicated show and airs on many networks. For more information about that, please visit provocativeenlightenment.com. This week's special episode of Breaking Limitations features Sandra Anne Taylor. So let me tell you a little about her. Sandra Anne Taylor is an international speaker, counselor, and consultant who lectures throughout the world on the power of eternal consciousness and personal energy. For more than 25 years, Sandra has been a counselor in a private psychology practice, working with individuals and couples in the treatment of anxiety, depression, addiction, and relationship issues. Her Quantum Life Coaching Program offers powerful techniques for connecting spirit, mind, and manifestation. Her multidimensional approach brings exceptional clarity and practicality to the science of whole life healing and personal achievement. In her newest book, The Hidden Power of Past Lives, New York Times bestselling author Sandra Anne Taylor offers a totally new and unique approach to the fascinating subject of karma and encoded consciousness, revealing how you can actually rewrite your past to change your future. Sandra's book, Truth, Triumph, and Transformation, is dedicated to examining all of the many influences on attraction, clearing out the fears and misconceptions that have recently become a common reaction. Sandra's New York Times best-selling book, Quantum Success, is still receiving worldwide acclaim for its enlightening and comprehensive approach to the field of attraction and achievement. Rich in practical application and easy-to-understand principles, Quantum Success has been called the real science of consciousness creation. It has been applauded by scientists, businessmen, and worldwide leaders in fields of consciousness dynamics for being the first book of its kind to connect success and achievement to the science of personal energy patterns. It is filled with eye-opening information and dynamic strategies that put the real keys to wealth and abundance at your fingertips. Sandra's many titles are available in 26 languages around the globe. Now, she has already anticipated my question regarding her songs of life, so here is her first. Bring him home. Bring him home. He's like the sun I might have known. If God had granted me a son, the summer's die, one by one, how soon they fly on and on. Okay, on that, let's get her in here. Welcome to Provocative Enlightenment, Sandra Anne Taylor.
Hello, Eldon. It's such a pleasure to be with you and to start my segment with listening to that wonderful song from Les Miserables.
Isn't that, I mean, it is incredible. In fact, I have to tell you that Hathaway's role in that, in my view, is the absolute finest piece of acting I have ever seen in my life.
Yeah, she was phenomenal.
Incredible.
Very, very
yes.
good. And I've seen a lot of stage productions, too. So for her to try to step in those shoes was a difficult process, but she really filled them. She was phenomenal. And that song that you played is, you know, it touches my heart because, you know, it talks about going home and being, you know, bring him home, bringing him to the spirit world. But later on in the song is my favorite line of all lyrics in all music, which simply says, to love another person is to see the face of God. And I get chills when I think about that. And when I look at my family and look into the faces of the people that I care about, and even into the faces of the people that I work with at seminars and in my private sessions, I make it an intention, and this has become such a spontaneous reaction. The deep, heartfelt love of the soul of this person brings me in a much more profound connection with the divine that connects us all.
Well, you know, I'm going to ask you why that song was important to you, but you've already stolen my thunder.
No, I'm sorry.
That is such a, you know, such a wonderful answer. One of the things that we do, Sandra, you know, we ask people what their songs of life are, and you'd be surprised. Maybe you wouldn't, but sometimes, you know, we have people that talk about, you know, how we're all one and love is the ultimate power in the universe and, you know, love will solve all the problems. And then they share with us songs that are, you know, country western favorites. My dog got run over by the train and my mother-in-law, you know. And you go, now, wait a minute, hold it. Isn't there an inconsistency here? So we do. You know, you are a psychologist. You understand why the question. We do get some self-disclosure from time to time.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I can understand that. I mean, people resonate with, you know, the different music that really connects with them at a certain time in their life. And because of that connection or an event or a relationship, It means something. It could be the crescendo of the music, a simple line like I talked about, or just the event that they connected to that makes it real. And really, that's all that matters.
You know, just this morning, when you say that, just this morning I posted on my Facebook page a new study that was, you know, all about how music brings memories back to the injured brain. And, you know, we've had some anecdotal information on that, but this is the first good study. And this is a full-blown study that is published in the Neuropsychological Rehabilitation Review, the Journal of Neuropsychological Rehabilitation, I should say. And it showed that with unerring accuracy, playing songs that were important to people of a given genre that they identified with, particularly through those teen years or were attached to, you know, emotions like falling in love and so forth, how literally just playing the music gave rise to recovering these lost memories. So you're absolutely right. Music is an incredible part of our lives and often just is taken for granted, just kind of overlooked.
It is, and I can't imagine living without music. I just can't. I mean, I have it on all the time or much of the time, and, you know, I have my favorites, but I listen to just about anything that resonates with me at the time. You know, sometimes I need relaxing music, sometimes, you know, really stimulating music to get my energy up, and you have to follow your intuition and go with whatever you're called to.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you, my wife, you know, for everybody out there, Sandra is a Hay House author, a fellow Hay House author, and she is a friend of ours. But and so you know Ravinder. My wife this last year said to me, Sandra, I want to do a marathon. I want to get ready for a marathon, and you know, and I'd like you to do this with me. I said, are you kidding? She said, no, I'm serious. So, you know, we started this marathon training, and I'll tell you, the first day or two, this was, there's no way, I've got to have something. So what I did is I took my smartphone and I loaded it up with all this music from my teenage years, you know, all this heavy-duty rock and roll. You'd be surprised at how much easier it was to run listening to that music.
It is. It's amazing. You know, I used to listen to my Walkman, which kind of dates me. When I went jogging, and it does, it keeps you going. It adds some time to your exercise there, and it can speed you up. That's, you know, yeah, kind of an entanglement, an entrainment kind of thing. When the beat gets faster, we go faster. So it's a good thing
to
know.
Isn't that true? But we feel younger too, you know.
Yeah.
Ellen Langer actually ran a study, and I'm sure you know about this, Ellen Langer from Harvard University, where she looked at that. But we've got a break, a hard break, and I'm late getting out of it. So I've got to run. Hold on. We'll talk about this more when we come right back.
You're listening to Provocative Enlightenment with Eldon Taylor.
Confusion, deception, manipulation, feeling a bit controlled, lost. Learn how you can take back control of your life through proven techniques in Eldon Taylor's revised edition of Choices and Illusions. This New York Times bestseller is a guidebook to your journey to self-actualization, filled with practical, real-life solutions backed by scientific studies and guaranteed to awaken your inner genie. Get your copy today from all bookstores.
Unlock the power of your mind. This is Provocative Enlightenment with Eldon Taylor.
Welcome back. If you just joined us, we're speaking with Sandra Anne Taylor about her path to success, her books and her works. And before we jump off of her wonderful music and start talking about her life, this was song 2.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be.
That's probably pretty self-explanatory as to why you like that one. But I've got to ask, what's its importance to you?
Well, it's pretty self-explanatory, that's true. But I do have to say that it really connects us with spirit. Now, I saw an interview with Paul McCartney many years ago, and he was actually, when he had a dream that his mother, whose name was Mary, came to him and said, let it be. And that's where the song came from. And when he says, Mother Mary comes to me, he's talking about his own mother. And but then, when everyone associated it with the mother of Jesus, Mary, the mother of Jesus, he liked that. So he never contradicted it in the public or made it a big deal. But for me, it's applicable kind of both ways, but I am deeply into connecting with spirit, and I have spirit come to me all the time, and they do whisper words of wisdom. And one of the greatest things that we can learn as a piece of wisdom is to stop striving and struggling and pushing and let it be and let ourselves understand the cycle we're in and move through it with, you know, love and self-compassion and to let it be, but also to open up to spirit. The whispers of spirit are always around us.
I didn't know that. That's a wonderful story. That's a wonderful insight. Thank you for sharing.
Sure.
All right. Our goal here is to develop a clear picture as to how the truly helpful and successful people, such as yourself, have gained the success that they have today. In doing this, we attempt to trace the path that led you from where you were to where you are today. So to begin, tell us a little bit about your early years, Sandra. What was school like for you? Were you popular, a member of a group, a loner, or how do you see yourself now looking back on it?
Oh, I wouldn't call myself as popular. I had my own little subgroup. You know, we were not the big men on campus, so to speak. But we had our, I had some friends that actually have stayed friends my entire life, which is rare and very fortunate. And I just saw my childhood as somewhat idyllic, but kind of Pollyanna-ish. And when I got into the real world, I didn't realize what I had to face in terms of relationships and all the stuff that one has to face when they're pretty much kind of not, I wasn't given a lot financially, but I was given a lot of support, and that really assisted me when I had to face my problems later in life. So it was an idyllic upbringing, but it kind of, it was a splash of cold water when I got into the real world and didn't and found out that, you know, people weren't as loving and embracing as what I had been exposed to in my large Italian family that are always loving and hugging and kissing and loving. And so I was very fortunate in that way. And I think it comes out, people always tell me that they can feel that energy because I just feel so, you know, I see the face of God in people. I love to connect with people. That is still a constant in my life. But I did, once I got married, I've been through two difficult divorces, had very difficult times in and struggles in some career issues. So, you know, the real world was a little bit of a shock to me. So that's what, and that's where I had to learn all the stuff that I write about.
And all the stuff that you teach, maybe, yeah. Too. But let's break that up a little bit so we we get some detail on it. Now, you're Italian.
Yes.
And you know, you're going to be raised in a Christian religion.
Yep.
And, you know, that's part of the family. That's part of the extended. That's the whole, you know, part of what you do together, especially on Christmas holidays like this one coming.
Yeah.
How important was religion to you, and does it continue to be the same thing? I mean, I hear from you spirit. I'm not sure. Are you still very Christian, or where are you now?
I would call myself Christian Buddhist spiritualist.
Now, a Buddhist is an atheist. They don't believe in God.
Oh, no,
so you
no.
just gave us everything.
Yeah, but I believe in a lot of Buddhistic principles, like Esho Funi, one's environment reflects their inner life force.
Right.
There's so many beautiful Buddhistic principles that
right.
Christianity doesn't even come close to. But I do believe in a consciousness, and I do believe that Christ was a prophet. And I believe since, you know, we're all sent by divine consciousness, and so Christ was a son of God, just like you are a son of God and I'm a daughter of God. There is, and he was a miracle worker. Christianity was important to me in its ritualistic and beautiful, loving themes that Christ brought to the table. What the problem with the Catholicism that I grew up with was the structure and the rigidness and the really judgmental and strict approach that, you know, the Catholic schools went through. But I was saved by my father, who, you know, I had an incident when I was young. They told us that the people that don't go to church are going to hell and the people that do are going to heaven. And of course I was going and my parents weren't. And, I, you know, would cry myself to sleep, thinking that I'd be separated. Here I was 7, 8 years old, thinking I'd be separated for all eternity from my parents who I love deeply. And my father heard me crying myself to sleep, and he came up and I told him, we had a long talk, and he told me that God doesn't judge us from our attendance at church, that our attendance in life is what creates our value and our gift to God. And then he said the most important words in terms of my Catholic upbringing, and never believe anything the nuns tell you ever again. So you hear about recovering Catholics? That was my moment of recovery.
I love it. All right. You know. So it was the guilt, the shame, and so forth.
But after 8 years old, I totally went into my dad's headspace, and I just saw it for the beautiful, you know, the ceremony and the beautiful teachings of, you know, Christ in his teaching, you know, brought love and that's what that shifted a consciousness in time. It ushered in, you know, the Piscean age. We're moving into the Aquarian age, and it ushered in the Piscean age where there was a loving consciousness that was opening up, whereas before that it was competition and deprivation and no consciousness of the beautiful soul within each person. And I think that the importance that Christ brought, the beautiful, beautiful message that he brought was about love.
Yeah, well, I certainly agree with that. You know, Hermann Hesse, the Pulitzer Prize-winning novelist of the book Siddhartha, essentially argues that we need to find our own river, so to speak.
Yeah.
Where we can live our lives fully aware of our daily duties and still totally participate in, you know, true enlightenment, which is for most of us our penultimate goal.
That's right. If
I understood what you say, that's the kind of life you're trying to live.
That's right. And I tell people, study everything and then pick what resonates with you the most.
Okay, when you think of yourself, Sandra, how do you describe yourself and your life's goals and ambitions today?
Well, actually, my goals and ambitions today aren't that different than they've been for the last number of years since I got more into the public eye. And it's really an expansion of what I did in my psychology practice, which is basically to help people love themselves and learn how to empower themselves in ways that they can get off of their limitations. And it's one of the reasons I wanted to join you with this, was because it's all about breaking through limitations. And I've done that so many times. And actually, there are many meditations that have been given to me and processes given to me through my limitations that have helped me break through, and in fact, I included most of those in the package that we're offering. So I really want, my goal is to empower the individual to shift consciousness on an individual basis, and then that goes, you know, expands in terms of the energetic vibration and the morphogenetic field, if you study Rupert Sheldrake. It expands with each individual consciousness shift into a more loving energy when we can be more loving with ourselves. So that is actually where I'm at now and where I've been for a while. It's my deepest desire to, you know, do that myself and assist others to doing that.
Okay, now you've alluded to a couple of things here, and I want to take them both on. I'm going to come back and ask you about the package that you've worked out with Ravinder. But before I do that, you know, you've talked about how you've overcome some limitations yourself. So, you know, share with us some of the darker moments in your life, the difficulties that you've had to overcome. Did you ever have a point where you just wanted to quit? You just wanted to give up? I mean, have you ever been on the end of you're the nasty, evil person and someone's accusing you of that? I mean, share with us what happened in your life and how you dealt with it.
Well, I have to tell you, my first set of difficult patterns were romantic relationships, which is why my first book, Secrets of Attraction, was so important to me, because it was about healing negative, addictive, dependent, and codependent patterns in relationships. And I don't know how I got into it. I believe in karma. I think a lot of it was karmic, but I was able to break through. It was, you know, it was just attracting people that didn't resonate with me. Although my second husband was wonderful in that he was the person that introduced me to quantum physics and set me on this whole path. And that was such a blessing. But he had an interesting idiosyncrasy. I was going to call it a flaw, but I'm not going to be judgmental, that he didn't want to work.
That's interesting.
So, and I was like, you know, I'm not, that doesn't honor me. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to be in a partnership where it's not a full partnership. So I had to leave that, and I was at a state where I didn't think I wanted to ever settle again, but I knew I was in my 30s, and I thought, well, I'm going to date again. So I don't, this is my first marriage was very toxic, abusive, actually. This one wasn't abusive, except financially, you know, totally missing. So I said, okay, I've got to change my relationship with myself. I had already been studying, as I said, he had introduced me to quantum physics. I've already been studying these principles for a number of years and teaching them to my clients in my psychological practice. So I said, what do I have to do? I need to send out my life force. I need to have a better relationship with myself and pick the highest qualities that I want to attract in a person and project them. And so I came up, as I was thinking about, you know, I'm going to date and I want to attract somebody stable and fun and who has the same values as I do. And so I just got this idea, and Spirit gives me so many ideas. I don't take credit anymore for what I'm just the venue, you know, so I'm the pen on the paper and the voice on the CD. But what I thought of was sending out a hologram. And if you study quantum physics, and I'm sure you know this, a hologram is the whole representation, even if you take only a piece of it. You can get the picture, and it's like three-dimensional. So I sent out a hologram of my higher self with the highest energies of, you know, value and fun-loving and self, you know, compassionate and all the things that I wanted, encouragement, all the stuff that I wanted, and equality. And I would just visualize my higher self going out into the field, the great field of all possibilities, and attracting that ideal partner, and then coming back to me and then choosing to live in these higher qualities. And I started that process, and it's actually one of the processes in the offer, the attracting love process. I started that process in about April or May, and although I swore I'd never get married again, I met my present husband in the end of July of that year. And so I was already out of my marriage, just out of my marriage, and thought, well, I just want to date a sane person, so let's do this. And Spirit gave me this wonderful process that attracted my husband and now is out there helping other people attract their ideal partners.
Distill that. You have to be what you want to attract.
That's right.
Okay. And it is a holographic universe that we occupy, so why not, you know, participate in that bubble?
That's right.
Can you define a moment or point in your life when you began to direct yourself to where you are today? I mean, is that something that happened when your father had that conversation? Or was there a catalyst at some other point in your life journey where you said, okay, enough's enough and I'm going to go this way?
I was a teacher, a high school teacher, and I was attacked by a student and almost raped at knife point. And I finished out that term, and I just couldn't go back. I couldn't go back. I could not go back. And I had already been studying. I was already in grad school studying psychology and stuff, and so I thought, this is the direction I'm going in. And as hard as that was, it was a very, very traumatic experience. But as hard as that was to deal with, it set me on the path that I am. It sent me into psychology, and then, you know, I started studying the quantum physics, started teaching it to others. They said, where's a book on this? There weren't any at the time that I knew of. This was back in the 80s. So it was a horrible event that led to an entirely new path for me and led me to where I am today.
the 80s, that would have been David Bohm and David Peet advancing those theories. But that was long before Talbot and the holographic universe.
Yes, so. It was.
All right. We have talked to a lot of people now, and your story, what you just told us about what happened to you in the school, is not unlike what we've heard from Joan Borisenko, Gary Renoir, many others, that there's a dark spot where something traumatic literally changes the course of their direction. They cannot continue, shall we say, in the river they're in. They have to change the direction of it. Do you think that that is evidence in any way, shape, or form of a path that we come into life in order to satisfy something that you might think of as karma or dharma?
I do. I do think that there is some, you know, direction that we start with, and we're kind of, I think the beginnings of our life are more kind of reactionary, you know, maybe following the path of least resistance, or just kind of just going in a direction that we just intuitively feel that might be the right way to go. But it doesn't necessarily mean that it's our whole life path. And then some event does change us. And oftentimes it's a dark event. It's not always a dark event, but oftentimes it can be. And the reason it is we get to that point where you simply cannot carry on the path, so you must find a new path. And I was fortunate that event turned out well. Someone walked in and saved me from the experience and possibly saved my life. I don't know what would have happened. But then the bigger picture then took me in a new direction. I believe that there was some karmic element in the path. I don't always believe that there's karma in every big event, however. I think it's more in the lessons we have to learn. I definitely had karma with that student. There is no doubt about that. But, you know, there's free will and there is ego and there's, you know, all sorts of things that get involved in personal choices, both others and our own, and that has a play in all of our experiences in life.
Now, I have to ask you this. Larry Dossey and I had a conversation recently about his latest book, The One Mind. And, of course, you know, The One Mind knows all, in Dossey's opinion. And based on his arguments, which gives rise to a kind of foreordination. Do you believe there is such a thing, predestination, foreordination? And if so, how's that square with the idea of free will?
I personally do not believe that everything is predestined. I believe that our soul chooses our lessons before we come in. I do believe our soul chooses our major relationships, too, because we have stuff to work out. But I don't believe, and some people believe that the moment you die is predicted, you know, everything is kind of ordered in a certain way. But I had a near-death experience, and it was very moving to me, and I was given in complete free will. There was nobody saying, you have to go back or you have to pass over this. I was standing at the edge of a river, and I talk about this in my book, The Hidden Power of Your Past Life. And in my near-death experience, I was absolutely free to do whichever I chose. So I really, because of that experience, which is so real to me, I can't believe that everything is predestined. Free will is, you know, a part of our evolution. We come here to evolve, to grow, to become enlightened, to help ourselves and help others to reach a higher level of enlightenment and connection with, you know, higher worlds and higher realms. And if everything's predestined, then it kind of knocks out our own evolution, because evolution comes a lot through our choices.
You're absolutely right. Not only is that the instance, but then we have to also look at how the mechanism works, and that gets even more perplexing, because as you know, MRI studies show us that, fMRI, I should say, show us that the unconscious is making those choices, and an MRI tech can know what we're going to decide as much as 10 seconds before we actually decide. But we'll pick that up when we come back from the break.
Okay.
I want to thank everybody for joining us today. In this first hour, we have been discussing with Sandra Anne Taylor her work, her life. In this next hour, we'll get into what that work is. If you're not already in our chat room, now's the time to get there. We have a movie for you during the break featuring today's guest, so be sure to go to provocativeenlightenment.com/chat and choose the chat room button near the top of the page. We'll be right back after a brief station break.
You're listening to Provocative Enlightenment with Eldon Taylor.
Unlock the power of your mind. This is Provocative Enlightenment with Eldon Taylor.
Welcome back. If you just joined us, we're chatting with Sandra Anne Taylor about her books, life, and work. But before we get back to the show, I want to invite you to join me on Facebook. I post regularly everything from where I am and what's on next to the latest in science, technology, and consciousness studies. And from time to time, some of my own opinions about the world we live in. And I love your comments and feedback, and Facebook is a great place for that. All right, back to the show. Before the break, we were discussing, Sandra, the notion that all this stuff that we put in our mind, all this that we take out of the media, the negative and the no don'ts, and the may combine with some of the karmic directions that you describe in your work to predispose our choices. And that might be what these fMRI technicians are seeing and why they're able to tell us what we're going to do or what we're going to choose before we choose. Your insight, your comments on that.
Well, I do think that we become habituated in some of our reactions, whether it's karmic or the stuff that you talk about, which is so valuable in terms of our predilection to certain thoughts and thought patterns and beliefs, or a combination of both. Whatever it is, I do believe we become habituated, and I do believe that brain activity can indicate when one of those habits or responses is being stimulated. My very dear friend Candace Pert, who recently passed away,
yes.
And I have often talked about, the neural pathways and the neuropeptides and that type of thing. So there can be indication in the brain in terms of where we want to go or where we're going to spontaneously go. You know, I mean, I've worked with clients with weight loss that every time their husband yells at them, they want to eat. I mean, there is a Pavlovian kind of response to emotional circumstances, and I do believe that can be indicated in brain activity. However, I also believe that the big decisions, big issues, the consciousness movements that we create are multidimensional and layered, and I believe that we, those of us who think about things like this, who really are trying to become more conscious, spend a little more time in making conscious decisions about not so much the reactionary stuff, but how to respond and where to go next in terms of bigger stuff. And that's one of the things I teach, that it's important to bring that consciousness into the little everyday moments, because it is, you know, we talk about defining moments, and most of us think of like the experience we've talked about and the experiences you've talked to others about as defining moments, which of course they are when we set a different direction in our lives. But also it's the accumulation of all the little moments that we unconsciously go through and just respond habitually to that define us. And so we need to take ownership of that. And I think that in that case, when we do take ownership, we can then create new neural pathways, and then a study of the brain will show, oh, she's going in a different direction here.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that's inherent, of course, in what you said, and it is an important part of what you do, is the fact that we need to train ourselves and not just allow that our habituated, enculturated, sum total of where so many people end up is who we are. We really need to stop and decide, you know, who it is that we want to be and make that personality correction, do that training in order to really, you know, manifest our highest, best potential. Would you agree with that?
I absolutely agree with that. And that's one of the reasons I love your books and your work and the Inner Talk so much, because it helps to promote that.
Well, and I love you too, but now I'm going to ask you the tough question, okay?
Okay, you can. I'm open.
All right. At what point, Sandra, did you say to yourself, I've made it?
I'm waiting for that point.
That's
can
a great
I get
answer.
Back to you on that? I will, you know, I'll email you when that the time comes.
You know, that is such a perfect answer from you. And the irony is, I have talked to so many icons in their field. And when I ask that question, there is always this deep hesitation and then some comment about, have I made it yet?
You know? Oh, I don't even have a question. There is no doubt that I have not made that yet.
Well, it is a very interesting tell, though. It is that humility, I think, that accompanies what you teach that gives rise to a good deal of why or where the credibility comes from.
Well, thank you. And it's genuine, and it's just being honest. And I see life as a process, and we're always processing stuff from the moment we're born till, you know, the moment we say, you know, I do. So I feel that, you know, for most of us, if we're really honest with ourselves, we would say that, you know, I'm still working on it.
Yeah. I have to change my clothes when I leave this one and enter the next one. That's what a friend of mine says. I just changed my clothes.
Right.
I just changed the level of vibration. And
that's
then I can
right.
look back and maybe determine whether it was a good go or not.
Yeah.
Depends on where I am on the ride at the moment when I answer that question. But you are considered today to be very successful. And again, your level of success, I am convinced that you have to have a passion attached to it. And that passion has to be renewed. It, you know, passion is like a fuel. It isn't something that lasts forever. You have to put more fuel in. So what is the source of your passion, and how do you refuel it?
Well, I think that the two biggest sources of my passion are the feedback that I get from people. I get emails from all over the world. I get emails in languages I can't read, because when people read the translations of my book in Norwegian or German or Italian, they think that I'm those things, and so they email me in those languages, and even the English speaking, as you got email, you read some of your emails earlier in the show. It's so fulfilling, and it's so motivating to keep on when people tell you have changed my life or you have saved my life. I've had people who tell me they were suicidal and ready to just, you know, check out and change their path because of something they were exposed to of mine. And it's that kind of gratification that motivates me to keep going and keep working on getting more and more of this information out there. The second piece is always finding something new about it. And the book I'm working on now, I'm so excited about, because it has a new process of decoding misinformation and thought patterns and recoding new information. And actually, I had been talking about this to Candace before she passed about creating new neural pathways. And I am so excited. And as you know, you are, you know, the provocative guy. You get the new information and you just jump on it. So you can understand how it can be so exciting to get, you know, something that you feel passionate and have it evolve into even more. Every step, you know, I've got I'm working on my eighth book for Hay House, and everything that I have done has had more, I've been given a different insight, a different approach, more techniques, a different kind of consciousness, and that newness really is what motivates me, besides the response from the wonderful people that I see at the seminars and that I hear from in my emails.
And I would ditto that. So now let me ask you this. Do you believe that everyone can achieve the kind of success that you have? Or is it something just left for a few? And if you think everyone can, what would you tell them they must do in order to succeed at whatever their goal?
Oh, there's no doubt in my mind that anyone and everyone can succeed at whatever thing that they feel passionate about. Here's the problem, Eldon. When people think, they think about the end result. And you have to think about the process. If you cannot feel passionate in the process, you will not get to that end result. You will not get to the end result. And there are many people who want to be a famous artist, a well-known writer, the best salesperson in their company, yet they don't like to make cold calls. They don't like to write. They don't have the discipline to sit down and do the artwork. You know what I mean? You need to have passion for the process, or I can guarantee you won't be successful in the end result.
That beautifully said. I want you to say that one more time. You have to have passion in the process. Say it.
You have to have passion. You absolutely need to have passion in the process and for the process in order to get the successful end result that you feel passionate about. People can easily feel passionate about sitting in that corner office and visualizing themselves. This is what went wrong with, you know, some of the issues of the quote law of attraction.
Right.
And
right.
People just got attached to the end without realizing all the stuff that went in the middle, you know, and so yeah, you have to feel passionate about the process, and if you don't, find something that both the end and the process stimulates you, and you can enjoy, get enthusiastic about, or feel fulfilled with.
And that's a quotable. That is a very quotable. It says it all. All right, now the big question, the one our audience has been waiting for. What one or two tangible tips do you have for our audience that they could employ today to change their lives for the better?
Having written 7 books.
Yep.
There are, you know, and I'm always a technique, practical kind of gal. I don't just sit and write a book about, oh, this is what the universe thinks and this is this philosophy and that. It's like, do this, do that, do this. So that I've got
right.
hundreds of stuff that I could say right now. But I have to say, it really, if you think about your life force energy, your whole, you know, when we talk about in quantum physics, a theory called consciousness created reality, and many physicists believe that that theory holds true in a very global sense and in a quantum particle sense. But it also holds true for the individual. Our individual consciousness creates our reality, but we have to look at what our consciousness is. What are we conscious of? Are we conscious, constantly conscious of what we lack, or conscious of what we have? So one of the very specific things you can do is shift from your what you're focusing on, which is your consciousness, to from the negative, the lack, the failure, to the what I have, the appreciation. I'm a success in this arena, even if it's just I'm a success in this moment of choosing this appreciation, this gratitude for this element of my life. That is, look at the shift in consciousness. What I lack to, mm-hmm. I'm a success because I can stop and have gratitude. I take gratitude breaks all the time, and still, and I have encouraged people to do that. There used to be a phrase called copying an attitude. I tell people to cop a gratitude.
That's good. I like that.
Cop a gratitude and look around and say, God, that beautiful piece of art hanging on my living room wall, I walk by it every day and I never see it. I never look at it. And I look at the colors and 10 seconds later, I'm back to doing whatever I was doing. But that shifts your consciousness. We have to realize that we have the ability to shift our consciousness in very deep and meaningful ways by changing our belief system, by really restructuring and recreating the person we want to be. But we can also shift our consciousness in doing these little consciousness quick shifts by deep breathing, laughing. Believe it or not, laughter, it actually shifts your consciousness, and it is the only human activity that stimulates all four quadrants of the brain. Even sex doesn't, unless you're laughing while you're having sex.
Hopefully you're not doing
hopefully
that.
Hopefully not.
That might cause some,
I don't recommend that one.
Feelings of insecurity. That laughter, by the way, also, while it's stimulating the brain, is turning loose those good neurochemicals.
It is
dopamine,
indeed.
It's the body's natural opiates. And,
that's
you
right.
know, you can fake a smile. Everyone should know that. Just fake that smile.
Yeah.
And the brain doesn't know you're faking.
That's
It'll
right.
give you that good dose. I think that's where fake it till you make it comes from, not
that's
from
right.
the sex side, does it? Okay. My favorite prayer, by the way, speaking of gratitude, is simply thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yes, it is wonderful. And yeah. it doesn't matter who the you is, whether it's the
no.
universe or a person that you're with or God or
maybe
just even
yourself.
Thanking yourself.
You know,
yeah,
thanking
yourself.
That divine intelligence or whatever you choose to call it that's within you that patches you perfectly when you cut your hand.
That's it right.
mends you when you get some virus or bacteria. You know, I mean, there's just, like you say, it's a shift in consciousness, but it's an all-important shift. Now, listen, you and I have talked about law of attraction before, and you know that I don't hold it in too holy a place.
Me neither. Not the way it was taught.
I know. At least if we think of the word holy as meaning, you know, sacred. I mean, if we think of holes,
yes.
and drill a hole in something, I could find a holy in that sense.
Oh, yeah. The
but you do a great job at discussing the problems with that, you know. So, and you've given us a little bit of that, but flesh out, if you will, what these problems are with the general way that people view this so-called law of attraction, as the secret put it forward.
Oh, there! It's so simplistic. It's just too darn simplistic. It's like I said, the whole life force. One, and these are, you know, and there are several things that I wrote about in my book, Truth, Triumph, and Transformation, that I call the lies of. Oh, thank you. I call them the lies of attraction. Not the laws of attraction. And one of the things is that if something bad has happened or is happening to you, then it's all your fault. And you know what? This is that's just crazy because, number one, there are a lot of things that influence our destiny, including some we've talked about a little bit about karma, but there are life cycles, there are soul cycles, there are social cycles, there are many different things that I talk about. And you can't fault yourself for everything that goes wrong. There was someone from The Secret who was on back when Larry King was on, and someone asked the question, well, my son has leukemia, I think it was. How did I create that? Someone called in and said, what about the girl from Virginia who was kidnapped, a little six-year-old girl, and raped and killed? And this man who was on The Secret actually said, it's the parents' fault. It's the parents' fault. Uh-huh. I got hundreds of emails after that. My son has, leukemia. My daughter has this thing. All these parents are going through horrible, hellish experience with their kids. And then they hear that, and they think they created it. Of course, it is not the parents' fault. If you add negation, to a difficult situation, what are you going to go? You're going to dig it deeper. You're going to dig it deeper. So you can't fault yourself. That's one of the lies of attraction. Another one is that, you know, there's only one source. As I said, there are lots and lots of sources, including regular life cycles. You know, and our soul intention is a source. If I had not been almost raped and possibly killed, I would not be sitting here talking to you today.
Right.
My soul had an intention to go in a different direction. Did I create that from my thinking? I don't think so. So we need to know that. And another false belief is that a false understanding of this is that you have to believe in order to make it happen. Now, you have to believe in yourself. You have to believe in your worthiness, your value, and your power. But some people email me and clients talk to me and say, I've never been in a relationship. It's hard for me to believe I ever will. And then they say, if you don't believe, it's not going to happen. But you can make it happen through your self-belief and an openness to receive all that I know I deserve on my soul level, my soul deserves. So many people, and this is such, you know, we talk about breaking through limitations. I have to tell you, I think one of the single most limiting elements in most people's lifetime is their lack of self-love, self-loathing, self-dismissal, self-negation. And if you know that your life force moves out in front of you, and you are a hologram, a piece of the whole, and you're going to attract what that life force puts out there, you need to know that you have to come from a different place, in defining yourself. And this is why I include so much spiritual stuff in my teaching, because that's where we really find our sense of our true power, our true value, and our worthiness. A lot of us didn't learn that from our parents. And in fact, most people don't learn that they are valuable and powerful and worthy from their parents. And so, you know, and the culture doesn't promote that unless you live according to certain ideals, like being a size zero or owning a Maserati or something.
Right.
So you have to come from a different place. And the true place of value and power, your truth and my truth, is that we are all, at the soul level, valuable beyond limit, powerful beyond limit, and worthy of everything the universe has to offer. And when we come from that place, when we come from that soul place, we become an irresistible magnet to good fortune, because the universe honors that.
You know, I love how you say that. Immanuel Kant made it very clear that human being seeks causes. We're wired in such a way that our brains seek causes.
Mm-hmm.
So we're always looking for that causal relationship, you know. And the problem with that is that, as you point out, when you begin to attribute where you are in life to this cause or that cause, that almost always means blame.
Yeah.
You know,
yep.
It's not my fault, you know, my mother and father this, or my, mm-hmm. you know, the school kid this, or you know, you know, as you point out, when these people in the secret start saying, well, it's due to the parents, you know, what we do in this whole causal relationship is find a way that we can cop out to blame.
Yeah.
James Arthur Ray in the Sedona collapse, and of course he was touted on Oprah's show. He was, you know, he was one of the big secret people. Actually, another secret person stepped out and said it was because of the secret that the Sedona episode happened, which implies then that, well, somehow Ray wanted this to happen, which also implies that the three people that died wanted it to happen.
Oh, I
you know. And then the
nonsense
that you get into when people go that way. I think if we just understand that our brains are made in such a way that we are predisposed to seek a cause, and that they're, that causal relationship is most often entirely false. But even if it's correct, it then inclines us to want to displace responsibility and blame. If we stop looking outside of ourselves, as you say, and begin thinking of ourselves in the mindset you've encouraged, everything in our lives will change. That's my two bits on it.
I agree. And you know what? Blame, you're talking about breaking through limitations. Blame
only... Okay, now hold that. When we come back, we're going to pick it up on blame. We have a break we have to get out of here for. We hope you're enjoying our show today with Sandra Anne Taylor and our discussion about her books, life, and work. You can visit her website to learn more by going to www.sandrataylor.net. That's SandraTaylor.net. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes and take your calls, answer your questions, so do stay tuned.
You're listening to Provocative Enlightenment with Eldon Taylor. Have you talked to yourself lately? What does that inner voice say? Are you constantly hearing negative feedback? Ready for a change? Inner Talk, Eldon Taylor's patented subliminal technology, can do just that. Change your inner self-talk. Turn off the negative by replacing it with positive affirmations. Inner Talk has been researched at universities such as Stanford and by governments around the world and has been proven effective at priming your self-talk. Armed with a new positive outlook, you'll find everything becomes easier, from losing weight to stop smoking, giving presentations to riding horses. Learn new things to being a powerful salesperson. Choose your title for change today. Visit www.innertalk.com. That's InnerTalk.com. InnerTalk.com.
Unlock the power of your mind. This is Provocative Enlightenment with Eldon Taylor.
The weary world rejoices for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn.
All right, Sandra, that was song three in your choices. What makes that so important?
Well, I'll tell you what. It's got my second favorite line after to love another person is to see the face of God. In the line just before the music where you started, it talks about something like, long live the world and sin and error pining. Then he appeared. And the soul felt its worth. It to me, this is the whole point of the human experience, to move into a sense of our worth through our soul, our soul worthiness. And the soul felt its worth. It's just a great concept.
I love that song, too. If you're just joining us, we're speaking with Sandra Taylor about her books, life, and work. We'll take your phone calls in this half hour, so if you have questions of our guest, either give us a call or submit your question in our chat room. Ravinder and her team, Andrea and Jana, are there to put your questions forward. Okay, now, Sandra, before the break, you wanted to flesh out this notion of blame. Take it on.
I'm loving what you said about blame, because it's so true. The mind wants to go to cause and effect, and it usually ends up in blame of others or self-blame. And any kind of blame goes deeper into limitation. This is what we're here to talk about, limitation. Blame limits our power. When we blame ourselves, we limit our power by choosing to see ourselves as faulty, wrong, and when we blame others, we limit our power by becoming victims. And so if I see myself as a victim, I won't take action in my own behalf. So blame-like guilt is a totally useless activity. You can identify things that you want to change without engaging in the negative aspect of blame.
Yeah, I actually don't think of them as being neutral whatsoever. I mean, they are, they're like binds. You may as well just tie yourself up and
they're not neutral, right? They're negative. The blaming, blaming has no positive influence on our personal energy or our consciousness.
Amen. All right, listen, we have some questions out of the chat room. So Elaine would like to know, Sandra, she says, we send out holograms and create things we decide we want to do. How do we know when we are truly following God's will, since we also create and come up with ideas, etc., that may originate within the human being alone?
Well, I have to say that the thing that gets me closest to divine consciousness is meditation. And so I feel that when in doubt, go into a meditative state and ask yourself two things. First of all, does it honor me? Does this decision, does this path, does this choice, does this person, does this whatever honor me? And if it doesn't honor you, it can't be God's will. I can guarantee you, if it doesn't, God will never ask you to dishonor yourself. You may be put in very difficult situations, even painful situations, but to make choices that dishonor you is not a part of our divine agreement here. And then the second question, in a meditative state, is to go into your heart and see what resonates with your heart the most. Get out of your head and see what resonates with your heart the most. And again, that will bring that element of divine consciousness as opposed to your own thought, your own ego, and your kind of mental processing can get out of the picture.
No, one of the things, and I'm going to steal another question here before I go back to the chat room questions.
Sure.
One of the things that you mentioned earlier in the show that was a composite of how you defined your spiritual belief was Buddhism. And to me, one of the great aspects of Buddhism is the teaching that we think of today as mindfulness.
Mm-hmm.
This idea of attending to all of our thoughts in a non-critical, non-judgmental
mm-hmm.
way, so that we become fully present. How important is mindfulness in developing, you know, your meditative states or your ability to discern, this is the divine way, this is my lower self's ego-attached desire?
Eldon, I think it's hugely important, and a lot of Westerners don't understand mindfulness because they think it means get more into your mind. But
right.
it means to become more conscious of that, just that presence quality, the ability to be present. And I feel that, and I talk about this in my book, Quantum Success, as one of the most magnetic energies is presence. In the present, we don't have to analyze things and fix things, because analysis takes us, we may need to fix the future, or we might feel like brooding about the past. But presence means I am just here now. I am present with my spirit, present in my body, and being in that state allows us to be clear. It allows us to be open, and that is so important in terms of creating a consciousness of clarity, openness, and receptivity to all that the universe has to offer.
Right, and you know, and I want to pursue something that you've said here, just for clarity purposes. Not that you need to be clarified, but the Western world misunderstands mindfulness because they think that means getting more into your mind. That was your statement.
Yeah.
And I think part of that comes about because so much of mindfulness training occurs in meditation. And typical meditation practices have you, for all intent and purposes, numbing out the physical mm-hmm. nature of yourself.
Yeah.
So like a hypnotized subject, you basically become desensitized to feeling, per se, at least, you know, all of those kinesthetic or other aspects of information that our mind truly processes, where mindfulness itself, that kind of training, integrates fully feeling as a part of being in the present.
Mm-hmm.
Have I got that right?
That's how I look at it. And, you know, there's,
okay.
To me, one of the biggest factors of truly being mindful in the Buddhistic sense is releasing the element of control. You know, it's like when we get into our minds to control things, to anticipate things, that's not what mindfulness is. It's actually the release of the need for control. I don't need to create an outcome. I don't need to, you know, I can just be in the
right.
present, just feel, be, and unattached. And
you know,
here is the irony, and people need to understand this about all of the principles of, you know, the various depth and subtle, deep and subtle layers of, whether you want to call it attraction or consciousness creation, is that when we let go of the attachment, we are open, much more open to receiving. This is the law of paradoxical intent. When we are desperate about something, we attach to the outcome and are urgent about it, that desperate, urgent energy, that attachment, the need for control, actually pushes it away. But
it's
when we let go, when we become mindful, we are open to receive.
Yeah, I love, you know, the way you say that reminds me of the story, and I'm not going to have this exactly right, but, you know, the Lord appears to a fellow during a quiet point of prayer. He says, "I have but just a moment." And the fellow looks at him all so excited and says, "Oh, but I have so many questions. You know, why did you create the universe? And why does the sun go round the earth?" And the Lord answers those questions patiently and then must leave. And what the fellow never did was ask the Lord, "What is it you're here to tell me?" And, you know, there's
great
irony in that
it
because
is.
We are so intent so much of the time in trying to direct our lives to use your word, be in control, when we're never really in control
right.
anyway.
That's for sure.
You mentioned Quantum Success, New York Times bestseller. Great book. I want to know
you.
Something. Did you use any of your principles or techniques to make that book a success?
Actually, I did, and it's a variation of the meditation that I came up to attract my present husband, and that was creating again a holographic visual of myself carrying the book out into the field of possibilities and seeing hundreds, dozens at first, hundreds, then thousands of lights coming to me and just passing the book out. And then, you know what I did? And I'm so spiritual, and I hope this isn't like too much out on a limb here for your very practical mind. But I visualized the angels helping, you know, hand it out and get it to all over the place. And then I just brought my hologram back, and this is actually, except for the angel piece, in the Attracting Success meditation, which is part of the offer as well. And I did that, but I did it with release. I had to release any attachment. I just did it for the fun of it and just saw it going all over the world, these lights, and then came back and lived my life in the way that I wanted to live it, in the energy to support that intention. And then it hit the New York Times, and now it's in 26 languages.
That's cool. I like that story. Now, listen, I'm a pragmatist.
Yeah,
I'm not,
I know
I mean,
you
I can
are,
be
Eldon.
Practical, But as a pragmatist, if it works, it works. You
That's can. Right.
I'm going to be looking for an angel to be passing out my next book.
Okay.
All right?
Okay. I think it's a good
Let's
idea.
Go to a chat room question. Mark wants to know, he says, Eldon, ask Sandra whether she's heard of the violet flame, and if so, what she thinks about it.
I've actually only just heard of it. I don't know any of the details about it. So I have to recuse myself from this answer, because I have just recently heard it. Someone told me about, you have to check out this violet flame concept, and I have not read or heard anything else about it.
We have a friend, Ravinder and I, her name is, she writes under a different name, so maybe I don't tell her real name, that writes about the violet flame. What is the name of her book?
The Teachings of Little Crow.
The Teachings of Little Crow. It's a great, great book. It's a fictional book, but it writes about it. And, you know, it's an interesting concept. But like you, I will pass to somebody who knows more about that. Viviana says that, and I assume she's speaking of you. I'm just going to read her comments. She spoke about soul intentions. I will assume these intentions are made unconsciously. So what about soul contracts?
Okay, our soul intentions are a lot of them are forged before we come here. That's why we meet the people that, our more intimate relationships are a part of our soul intentions, and our big life lessons are our soul intentions. Soul contracts, I do believe that soul contracts exist in that we are connected with each other. I'm a little hesitant to use the word contract because some people means that a contract is binding and you cannot change it. One of the things that I taught in Hidden Power of Your Past Lives is that you absolutely can change your karma, but we are contracted. We are we do attach to emotions and patterns and people through strong emotions. We attach through strong emotions. Now, if it's love, I might attach to my present husband who I love dearly and come back just out of the desire to be with that person. But if it's a resentment, that attaches us to, and it builds what it could be considered a type of contract, that I have to come back and learn how not to be resentful, how to reclaim my power if we've been very submissive. This is one of the three big karmic causes of repetition, compensation, and retribution. And when we get these contracts where we've been submissive and we attract these overpowering and demanding people, our contract is with the person. It is not binding, but our real soul intention is to learn how to empower ourselves and change that pattern of relationship. So it's important to know that we have the freedom to change this.
That's cool. Now, Viviana has qualified this, and I'm just going to add her qualification in.
Okay.
So if it's important, then you know how to treat it. Okay. She says, I ask because I don't see a difference between soul intention, contract, and if so, then why would it not be possible that James Ray's soul intended for such an event to happen?
Oh, I don't believe that events are planned. I think our soul intentions are our life lessons. I'm sorry if I misled you on that, honey.
No, you didn't. You didn't. I just wanted that clarification.
Yeah.
I don't think
the events are planned. I think our life lessons, like I have to learn how to love myself. I have to learn how to be stronger around men. You know, these are the soul intentions. I don't think the actual events are planned.
Right. Well, and that leads me to this next question, which is about your book, The Hidden Power of Your Past Lives. There you talk about encoded consciousness. Now, you've kind of alluded to that and a little bit has dribbled out. What I want you to do is flesh out what you mean by encoded consciousness, because I think that adds some clarity to this whole issue.
Sure. As I said before, we each have our own individual consciousness, and scientists define consciousness as a field of information. Our consciousness is a field of information about ourselves. But what most of us don't realize is that our encoded consciousness pre-existed this life and will continue to exist after we leave this suit of clothing, as your friend calls it.
Right.
So it actually existed through all these lives, and we build a code of patterns. And through these processes of repetition, compensation, in other words, if I starved in a past life, I might overeat in this life, and then I might starve in the next one. I might bounce back and forth. These patterns are become a part of our code, and we can learn what those codes are, and we can do something that I call rescripting and create a new code. We can actually change what has happened in the past, because you and I know that the time-space continuum theory says that all time exists at the same time. So we can actually reach back into the past, which is actually happening energetically right now, change it, change the code, and move on. And I've had so many people change their lives through this process. It's been monumental. Do I have time to tell a little story?
Oh, yeah, please do. And while you're at the story, I mean, you have in this program that you're making available, you have a meditation on this, do you not?
Yes, we have actually Sharon Klingler's, who my sister, her journey into past lives. My CD is in my book, The Hidden Power of Your Past Lives, which I just found out is totally sold out in English. It's available in other languages.
But not in English.
It's totally sold out in English right now. You might get a few copies on Amazon. It's got a CD in it with a regression, a rescripting, and that type of thing. But there is a regression in the offer that we have and a lecture on past lives and their influence.
Tell us the story.
Yes. I had a woman in one of my classes that asked about what causes fertility issues. And immediately, one of the things I do is I see past lives in my readings. And so I saw her instantly. In a pioneer days, she had like 8 kids under the age of 10, and she was resenting it and exhausted. And I got into her energy, and it was just exhaustion and resentment. And I kept hearing, I can't have any more children. I can't have any more children. I can't let myself have any more children. And so she coded that as an intention for this life. And so what we did is we rescripted it. We recreated some releasing toxic attachments. We did all sorts of stuff. Which, by the way, there's some of that in the intentions and affirmations in some of the processes on the offer as well. And what happened is she ended up having a beautiful baby boy in spite of the fact that she only had one ovary.
Oh, fantastic. All right. Listen, Ravinder, we've been talking going around and around the merry-go-round here about this offer, and I'm not totally sure what it is. Please flesh that out for us.
Yeah, the offer is something that we worked out with one of Sandra's people, you know, in her office. And what they managed to work out was they took, I think it's 20 of Sandra's best meditations on a wide range of subjects, you know, bundled it all together. They tell us that this is normally a $110 value, which to me is dirt cheap for 20 different programs. And they are offering it for just $53. You know, you can download them, access them right away. But she covers things, you know, from attracting success to, you know, attracting relationships, energy breakthroughs, you know, chakra clearing. She's got some programs for health and healing in there as well. My favorites, I think, are from the openings package. And she's got things like opening the door, connecting to the spirit, or windows to the soul, your spirit's heart and intuition. But, you know, she's got meditations for all of these different areas all combined. So I think that is, you know, a heck of a deal. A great process. You know, you can learn how to meditate by experiencing the process, and sometimes having an audio recording, first of all, makes it so much easier.
That's a fact. Okay, so now we know what it is, and where does everybody go?
To get the package, just go to provocativeenlightenment.com, click on special offers, and we have the link posted there. That's always the easiest place to get any of these special offers.
You know, one of the things that I like about doing the teleseminar, webinar, whatever you originally decided this thing was going to be, on the radio network is that we get a lot more depth. We learn a lot about the individual, and you right away know whether this is somebody you want to follow, you want to pay attention to, you want to learn from, or you don't. All right, Sandra Anne Taylor, I'll listen to you any day for what that's worth.
Well, the feeling is mutual, Eldon.
Oh, thank you. You've just released a new Oracle card deck called Energy Oracle Cards. Tell me about that.
Oh, I'm so excited. It just came out this month, and it's available at Hay House. Believe it or not, they're offering it and several other card decks as stocking stuffers for $5. I don't even know how they can do
that. Great.
And the app is available. The iPhone app is available December 16th. The link is not up yet, but if they go to my website, sandrataylor.com, on December 16th, they'll be able to get the iPhone app for only $6.99. I'm very excited because, as I said, I do these readings and I use the images that I see in my readings so people can give themselves readings as well, figure out where their energy is, help themselves answer questions about what to do next, and just how to deal with their energy. Every single card also has an affirmation, so it can create your intention for the day.
Okay. You know, Sandra, I gave your website as sandrataylor.net. Is it both, sandrataylor.net?
It is both. It used to be .net because sandrataylor.com was owned by a stripper.
Oh, so that was your alter ego.
That was, okay. Yeah, there's a metaphor in there somewhere.
Do you have an oracle deck of that kind, too?
I'm teasing.
Sandra, it's been wonderful having you on the show. You're a great guest. You're full of inspiration, full of spirit, as you say. And I love how you frame everything, how you're so open and willing to share of yourself. So once again, we're at the end of the show. I just want to express my deepest gratitude for having you spend your time with us today.
Well, thank you, Eldon. It was purely my pleasure, and I love you and Ravinder, and I enjoyed myself very much, and it's always a joy to be with you.
Well, thank you. Well, we've come to the end of another episode of Provocative Enlightenment. I want to thank all of you for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed our show, and we'll join us again next week, same time and same place. And do tell all your friends. Let's have them join us as well. And please, if you have comments on our show, do let us know. Okay, until next time, wherever you are in the world, remember, believing in yourself always matters.
Provocative Enlightenment has been brought to you by Progressive Awareness Research and other sponsors. Provocative Enlightenment is a syndicated show and appears on other networks. For a schedule of show times, visit provocativeenlightenment.com. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor, write to Eldon at eldontaylor.com.